For 35 years, Elton John has been a rock and roll superstar. He's sold over 200 million records, and he's never been afraid to say what he thinks. Tonight, Elton talks more freely than ever about his fellow celebrities, the performers who've inspired him, the challenges of mounting an American spectacular, bringing a smash hit film to the London stage, and his battle to stop the spread of AIDS. From the shanty towns of South Africa to the casinos of Las Vegas, we go inside Elton's world.
And they made you change your name. It seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. I would have liked to have known you.
While he's in England, this is home for Elton John. Woodside, his country estate just outside Windsor.
Here we are in the library. Which is your favourite sort of reading matter?
I'm a big biography and autobiography person, and I'm a big avid collector of photography books and art books, but I mostly read biographies.
Well, when you mention photography, that Helmut Newton book over there is the biggest book I've ever seen. It's not a question of I could not put it down, it's a question of I could not pick it up.
Well, actually, it's now been surpassed by a book by Jeff Koons on Muhammad Ali called Goat. It actually weighs more than that one. So coffee table books are now becoming dining table books.
Becoming dining tables.
Becoming dining tables themselves, yes. Buy a book and eat for four.
One of the other quotes you made, you said, I couldn't be in a better place in my life right now.
No, I think that's pretty accurate. I'm extremely happy with my relationship with David. We've been together for 10 years, 11 years, and we're extremely happy, and we get happier every year. I suppose every family has its ups and downs. And, yeah, you do. You have rows, you get through them, but the secret is communication. And, you know, sometimes you need help, and then people help you out. And David and I have never been in the position where we've had to go to other people and ask for their help. We've always sorted our own stuff out, but it's never been a question of us having major rows. We just have rows over the silliest thing.
You announced you're going to get married the other day.
No, I've never said we're going to get married. What I've said is that if the law comes into being in England where the civil partnership thing is, which is going, albeit slowly, through the motions of coming into to law, then David and I will definitely sign that civil agreement to protect ourselves and to show that two people of the same sex can actually commit to themselves and have a wonderful relationship. And I think that's a very important. And I will do it privately as far as celebrating it, but I will do it if they want me to do it publicly. I will do it publicly. I won't hide it from the nation. I'll say, yes, I am going to do this. You know, we live in an age where there's a lot of bigotry around at the moment. It seems to be a real divisive issue, the gay marriage issue. And I can understand that. But at the same time, I'm a human being, and I think I deserve the same rights as someone else to have a partner and to protect that partnership and to celebrate that partnership.
Outside his personal life, in his spare time, Elton has been ruffling quite a few feathers lately. He kicked things off with a bravura performance at Taiwan Airport. Then he accused Madonna of miming during a live show. He offered to apologise, but was soon at it again, claiming George Michael was wasting his talent by hanging around the house and not performing live, and advising Victoria Beckham that she should spend more time with husband David in Madrid.
I was asked questions about Victoria and David and George Michael, and it came on the end of the incident in Taiwan and the Madonna incident. My image seems to have sort of become a bit of a grumpy old man and someone who just won't shut up about people's problems. They asked me the questions and I answered as honestly as I could, and I thought without hurting people, but maybe I should have just shut up and not said anything.
Well, the Madonna thing's a thing that actually you're a real maven for live shows. I mean, that's why you went after the lip-syncing, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, and it was also at a very festive lunch where, you know, it was very, very... it was the great British nothing is sacred kind of a thing.
Madonna, best fucking live act. Fuck off! Since when has lip syncing been live? Sorry about that, but I think everyone who lip syncs in public on stage when you pay like 75 quid to see them should be shot.
It was said in good humour, but I can see why she was pissed off with me. And to be fair to her, as I said in articles afterwards, she's probably the least culpable of some people. But I do feel as if you should go and see a show, you should see a live show.
That's me off her fucking Christmas card list, but do I give a toss? No. Thank you very much.
I did sent a Christmas card to her with a little note on the outside, but it was turned... It came back once, and I sent it again, and it came back again, so I was obviously it's rattled the cage somewhat.
Well, maybe an Easter card might
maybe
do
an Easter
trick.
Card, yeah.
And you and George Michael sort of almost enjoy joshing one another, don't you?
Well,
you
no, say I don't. I don't. I mean, I was concerned. They asked me about George, and I am concerned about George, and I know the position he's in. And it really angered him. Again, I said it out of love because I care about him. He's incredibly talented. I think every creative artist goes through periods of self-doubt and stuff like that. I don't think he's looking after himself in the best way possible, and I was trying to say that. I did try and call him over Christmas to say, listen, you can have a go at me. I don't give a shit. You know, whatever I've said was meant to sort of rattle your cage a bit, and it obviously did. And, you know, in 1989, when I was being... or 1988, or when I was at the worst of my behaviour, if someone had said the same thing about me, I would have reacted the same way as George Michael had done. I would have told everyone to piss off. And sometimes the truth hurts. I just wish he'd look after himself a little better because, you know, at the end of the day, he's wasting his creativity because he is by far and away one of the nicest people in the world, one of the loveliest, most kindest people in the world. And he's in the situation that I got myself into, situation where he won't listen to anybody. And if it means that he's not going to speak to me for a couple of years because he's, you know, oh, so be it. But I'm, you know, sometimes tough love is the best.
Coming up, Elton John and that tussle at Taiwan Airport. His new video single, co-starring Terry Hatcher. And his historic duet with Ray Charles.
What have I got to do?
What about Taiwan? How did that come about? Few people have had such fame travelling to Taiwan.
Yes, exactly.
And it was all at the airport.
We were just ambushed. We came to the main terminal. In all the papers afterwards, it said I threw a hissy fit because I wasn't met on the runway by cars. We knew in front that we were going to have to go through the terminal. It's no big deal. I just thought the photographers were going to be outside after you've gone through immigration. We came out the elevator, and these people were in your face, in your face, in your face. 12 o'clock at night after travelling for 9 hours. I just wasn't in the mood for it. In the end, they were so rude, I just lost it. Maybe I'm 57, but I just can't cope with that kind of rudeness. And it was intolerable. You know, can you just let us have 5 or 6 yards? No, they're in your face. And then it's like, why don't you fuck off out of our country? And I said, well, I've only just got here, thanks very much. I've never seen media able to go through X-ray machines without being stopped, ever. Yeah. Yeah. So it was an intolerable situation. I probably should have just bitten my lip and said anything, but you know what? I was tired and I won't be treated like that.
And you said once too, I know I'm a larger-than-life character. I've made my own cross to bear. I'm a victim of my own image.
I think people, you know, when they write about me, write about the hissy fits. I mean, what really hurt me before Christmas was that a couple of women journalists said I was a misogynist and woman-hater, and that really upset me because most of my best friends are women, and I love women very much. My best friend in my life has been my mother, so I'm definitely not a woman-hater. I do too much for women to the other. But, I mean, that really got to me. So I am a victim, yeah. I'm my own worst enemy sometimes, probably. But, you know, it's very hard to shut up. I mean, why should you shut up about things? Why do we have to say nothing? Why can't we have an opinion?
Does it get more and more difficult as time goes on, or more and more easy to stay, as you have done, off drugs and booze?
It's not a battle, and it had, never has been. There are times when I would love to join in and have a glass of red wine. It's so, you know, sophisticated, it's so delicious. But you can't have everything you want in life. And if you have to make that the sacrifice I have to make for the life I have now, then I have to, I just know myself too well, David. I know that one, it would sneak up on me. I would maybe have one glass of red wine to start with, but then I'd maybe have two. And it would snowball. That's my personality. That's the person I know that is inside of me. And I just can't take that risk. And I don't want to. It would ruin everything that I've worked for in the last 14 years, and be 15 years this year. And I have no problem. Most of my friends drink. I have no problem about it. I have I'm an expert on non-alcoholic beer. I could do non-alcoholic beer tastings for you.
Yes.
Expert on water. Expert. But you know, my life is fantastic. No, it's not hard at all.
No.
No.
It's a no-brainer.
It's a no-brainer.
It's a good deal. Yeah. It's a good deal, despite what you have to give up.
I haven't really had to give up anything. Yeah. No, I've gained so much. What have I given up?
I ain't gonna die, I ain't gonna cry, I won't wear my heart out on my sleeve. You can take the car, but you won't break my heart. Oh, and darling, turn the lights out when you leave.
Tell me about how Peachtree Road came about. The title and the album.
The album, I decided to record in Atlanta. I have a home there. I live on Peachtree Road. The studio was on Peachtree Road, albeit 20 miles away from where I lived, because Peachtree Road goes on forever. So I wanted to call it Peachtree Road. It's been critically acclaimed, but it hasn't really set the charts on fire, which in one way is disappointing. But for me, the most important thing was that it sounds like I wanted the record to sound. It sounds like musicians playing, and I love the songs in it. We've got Terry Hatcher playing the girl in the video, which is very exciting because she's suddenly burst the fore again with Desperate Housewives. This single is my favourite single. It's a country and western song, and it has a very southern feel to it. We used a lot of local gospel singers on it. I sing really well on it.
You've got your singles dry if you think that I'm a male. I ain't gonna die.
What is it that makes songs work? How is it when you hear it, you know it's going to work?
There are certain songs that you know when you finish them, they're a little bit more special than others. They don't come around that often, and you just can't pull them out of thin air. It's incredible that probably my most successful song was my first hit, which is your song, and I've sung that every show that I've ever done.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live.
You know, it's like usually where do you go from there? You usually go downwards. But recently, things like Tiny Dancers, Someone Saved My Life Tonight, Sorry Seems to Be the Hardest Word, and Candle of the Wind have come through as being, you know, just as popular. When I wrote Daniel, I knew that was a special song. They don't come around that often. And when you do, you kind of know that it's a bit better.
Like Daniel,
you're always in search of that holy grail, the most perfect song. Mm. And that's what keeps you going.
And a one, two, three part of all and a one.
The next hit, he hopes, will be the stage musical version of the film Billy Elliot.
Three part of all and a one, two, three part
of all.
I beg your pardon.
The story of the working-class boy who struggled to become a ballet star in the face of opposition from his father.
Did you see a little of yourself in the story?
I went to the Cannes Film Festival when it was screened and had to be helped sobbing from the seat afterwards, very embarrassed. It struck a nerve with me because of the relationship that I had with my father and, you know, my father coming round in the end to acknowledging what I'd done and, you know, being pleased about it in the end. And so it was kind of the same kind of story. And I said, we've got to do a stage musical with this. And I would have only done it if Stephen Daldry and Lee Hall had been part of the team. There's no good doing Billy Elliot without Stephen Daldry because it's his baby. And Lee Hall, who wrote the screenplay, I said, listen, you've got to write the lyrics. No one else can do it. So it's an incredible challenge. If he gets it right, and I think he will, it'll be a tremendous, tremendous success because it's such a heartwarming, incredible story. And the music, I think, enhances it.
Have you, in terms of heroes, are your heroes in music still Brian Wilson or Bob Dylan?
Brian Wilson, Ray Charles.
You did the last recording with Ray Charles, didn't you?
For Genius Loves Company, which was his duets album. The last duet he did was with me, with Sorry Seems to Be the Hardest Word. Very emotional day in the studio in Los Angeles. I mean, we all knew that he wasn't well, but we didn't know that he was that weak. And they said, well, maybe he's got 2 or 3 weeks to live. And that was tough, but he was wonderful.
I'll sing the first verse, you
sing the second.
I'll sing the bridge, or whatever you call that.
And he sat in a chair, and we sang it together. And we did about 2 or 3 takes, and his voice was a little weak, but still had at points the fire that you know that he's always had.
What do? When lightning strikes me, what have I got to do? Sorry seems to be the hardest word.
I kept all the outtakes when he was speaking to me. I've got it on a separate CD because, you know, he's singing words like, it's sad, it's a sad, sad situation. And people who have been around him for a long time that were in the control booth were just, you know, breaking down in tears because they knew that they wouldn't see him again ever in a recording studio.
Sad, so sad, it's a sad situation, and it's getting more and more absurd.
Thank you so much, sir.
It was a tough day, and also an extremely proud day for me because I've performed with him on first television show I ever did in America was the Andy Williams Show with Mama Cass and Ray Charles, and Ray Charles and I did a duet, and I was so terrified of playing with Ray Charles. Here I was just going over to America, and I had to play a black piano, and he had to play a white piano, and everything he sings seems to be in D-flat, which is a killer key. I actually write a lot of songs in D-flat, but at that time hadn't. And we sang Heaven Help Us All, the Stevie Wonder song, and he was so sweet to me then. I mean, there's so many people that inspire me. I don't really listen to old songs that much. I listen to people like Nina Simone a lot because I think, to me, she was the best.
My baby don't care for shows. My baby don't care for clothes. My baby just cares for me.
If I'm going to name one artist, creative artist, and performer of the 20th century, she would be my favorite artist because not only did she sing and play the piano, she was an incredible pianist.
Your love is all. I love all things about you.
I remember listening to a tape that she'd recorded. The interviewer asked her, you know, if she thought interracial marriages were a good thing. She said, absolutely not. And then the interviewer said, well, you were married to a white man. And she said, yes. And we were crying. We were like, she was a complete contradictory woman, but she had fire, she had passion.
Your heart, your soul, my love.
But I actually got to sing and be with her at the last concert she performed at in New York, which was the only time I've ever met her, and it was a very emotional moment for me because, you know, she can be extremely terrifying.
Yeah. She was a daunting lady to meet, wasn't
a
she?
A daunting lady, an incredibly beautiful-looking, proud woman. She'd had a stroke, which impaired her singing a little bit, but she was fantastic. She was sitting in a chair with Patti LaBelle, who looked after her throughout the whole concert, and they stood up for her, man and woman, at Carnegie Hall, and she just sat in the chair and cried because she knew she was never going to perform again. And it was just, I'm tearing up now as I think about it. Those kind of moments, you stay with you forever, and the Ray Charles one will stay with me as well.
Do you still miss people you've lost, like Gianni Versace and Princess Diana?
There's not a day goes by where I don't think about Gianni, and I wish he was here. And, you know, still being friends with his family, brings that home all the time. And yeah, I missed. I mean, Diana was not nearly as. I was never as close to Diana as I was Gianni. Gianni was, you know, a phone call a day, and, you know. But yes, I do miss her as well. And I think if she was around, you know, the compassion side of her and the ability to cut through and communicate to people. Yes, she was flawed, but you know, the good things outweighed the bad things, and she had that incredible way of breaking through and communicating with all sorts of people, whether they were rich, poor, or had nothing, and made them all feel special. And that is a very special talent to have. So yes, I miss her. I miss her spirit and her willingness to talk out on things, issues that she believed in. And I, you know, if she was still around, she would probably have learned, you know, from her mistakes. We all make mistakes.
And of course, there's one member of the royal family who's died, not in such tragic circumstances, because she was over 100. But she was a mate of yours in a way, wasn't she, the Queen Mother?
She was always so nice to me, and always. I remember her coming round here for popping in after church at Easter with some of the other members of the family, and I asked her what she'd like to drink. She went, "I'd like a Dubonnet and lemonade." I went, "God, nobody's had a Dubonnet in this house." You know, we had to rush out to the loft license, and she told me the history of this house because her friend lived here in 1940s. And I never considered her. I was never frightened of her in a way that, you know, she was always so easy to deal with, on a conversational level.
You danced with her, or was it with the Queen, to Bill Haley?
I danced with the Queen to walk around the clock, and I'll never forget that. The Queen has an incredible good sense of humour. Her timing is impeccable. And there have been very funny moments I've had with her. And she has the driest sense of humour, which if you watch that old documentary on her, and when she's having her portrait painted, and they say, you've got to throw out the first pitch at the baseball game, and she sits there for about 30 seconds, and she goes, are you sure? And it's like, she's going, why? What am I doing? the poor woman is subjected to doing the most incredibly awful things sometimes, and she takes it all in good stead. No, I've always gotten along really well with her.
Coming up, Elton's Red Piano Spectacular from Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas. Elton John was writing songs about America long before he ever went there. And it was in America that he had his big break in 1970 in Los Angeles. Now he's come to Las Vegas, a graveyard for a lot of performers, but a runaway success for Elton. His Red Piano show at Caesar's Palace is sold out every time he plays there. America in general, Elton. I mean, When you first came on your first big trip was 1970, wasn't it, really? That was the Your Song. Was America the way you'd imagined it as a child?
It was everything and more, better. And it was the biggest love affair you could possibly have. I mean, I'd always wanted to come to America just to buy records and see some shows and go to the movies and eat popcorn and stuff like that. But having become successful so quickly and having got to meet and play with some of my heroes so early on in my career made it even more satisfying. I say at the end of the show, I've always loved this country. Without this country, you know, accepting me first, who knows what would have happened? But I broke in this country first and then back in England the second. It sometimes is the reverse situation now. People happen in Britain first, like the Scissor Sisters and the Killers, and then they happen in America second. But I was the opposite. I happened here first. So I grew to love this country and have the most fond memories of touring, meeting the greatest people. I mean, hanging out with Groucho Marx, hanging out with Mae West, meeting Josephine Baker. I mean, meeting the real, you know, the people of history, Cary Grant coming to my show at Dodger Stadium. It was a special place. It has changed.
How has it changed since 1970 to today?
I don't think musically is as exciting as it was anymore. I don't think there's as much great talent coming out of this country. I think black music is a huge disappointment compared to how it used to be. There are a few exceptions, of course, and there always will be. I think more innovative things seem to come out of Britain and Europe, as far as I'm concerned. That's not to say there aren't great musicians and songwriters. One of my favorite songwriters in the world, Rufus Wainwright, comes from here. But I find that music has stagnated, and you know, there was a time in the 70s, throughout the 70s, where you could buy 10 or 12 great albums a week. Now you're lucky if you can buy 10 a year. It breeds people who don't have the training to go out and play live, but they can make hit records and a great video and look fantastic. But actually, when it comes to delivering the goods, they can't do it because they haven't had the experience of going on the road.
We're here in Vegas, and your show, rated by everybody, all the papers, is the best show in Vegas. That must give you a lot of pleasure.
That did give me a lot of pleasure, because when I initially said I was coming here, a lot of skeptics, and I understood how they felt, thought, well, you know, it's a traditional thing for an older musician to go to Vegas and spend the last days of his playing career there, but that's not what I wanted to do. What I wanted to do when I came here was to do a live rock and roll show without using dancers on stage and do a visual show. Initially, we were going to spend $600,000 on the show, and you know, that would have gone probably just about to cover my costume. So we had to have a major rethink. If you're going to do something in this town, you have to make a major investment. I've only got to play for an hour and a half, so they don't want me to play longer than that because they want people to go into the casinos and spend money in the shops and the restaurants. So it's a precision show. And I employed a great use of the screen that's behind me, which is 120 feet wide by 40 feet high.
And how do you pick among, in order to get the playlist of the songs you're going to do? They're all your babies. I mean, how do you pick which babies to?
Whichever songs went well visually. I asked my friend David LaChapelle, the photographer and video maker, if he'd produce the show for me. He was very instrumental in helping me pick the set list and the order of it, because he had a visual idea of what it should be. And we just came to the agreement ourselves, what would be the best visually. He went to shoot films of some of the songs. We gave him, for example, an 11-minute, 19 live version of Rocket Man. He cut a film to that exact time. Oh, I'm a rocket man. footage to Rocket Man is actually the footage that he shot with Justin Timberlake playing myself for a video called This Train Don't Stop There Anymore. But it works so brilliantly for Rocket Man. And it shows the loneliness of fame and the loneliness of being a Rocket Man. It's, and while I'm singing about being alone up here, this poor boy, is, which is me in the 70s, is being chased by all these people and having to say hello to all these people. Finally, he gets onto the stage where he feels, thank God I'm out of here and I'm alone now and I can do what I want. There's a lot of humour, there's a lot of deep thought into it. The Marilyn Monroe footage, for example.
Well, you had said you thought you'd never sing that song again.
I didn't think I would because, you know, after the circumstances and the fact that it was an incredible tragedy, I just, out of respect for the family, I didn't think I'd sing it again. I didn't want to sing it again. But it's been 8 years now, nearly, and I just thought it's one of the classic numbers.
It's not about Diana, you do it.
I do it about Marilyn Monroe.
Goodbye, Norma Jean, though I never knew you at all. You had the grace to hold yourself for those around you crawled. You crawled out of the woodwork.
It looks so much like Marilyn Monroe, but it's not, it's a lookalike. It looks like some of the Burt Stern footage, and it's rainy and old, and like the Burt Stern footage of Marilyn herself.
It seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. I would have liked to have known you, but I was just a kid. Your candle burned out long before the legend ever did.
The first half of the show, there's just a visual feast and beautiful things to watch, and then it all goes crazy and the balloons come down from the ceiling. And I think there's something for everyone. There's someone who won't look and see something deep in there, but will come away loving Pamela Anderson pole dancing or whatever.
Great quote I found by the pianist Arthur Schnabel. I wonder if you agree with this. The notes I handle no better than many pianists, but the pauses between the notes, ah, that is where the art resides. Yes. Is that true?
It's the space in the playing that is the most important. And I found over the years, when I had a three-piece band, initially when I came here with just drums, bass and piano, I found that my piano playing was far more adventurous. And I listened back to the records when we played live. And some of it is quite astounding. And then as you add more musicians, there's less room. And you tend to overplay, and I would say that's true. So I've learned not to oversing and also try also to not to overplay the piano. It's difficult sometimes when you've got a fairly large band. So what you play is might be there, but it's what you don't play that's really important as well.
Yeah.
It's a great quote.
And in terms of your voice and your performance today, people say that your voice is stronger, richer, deeper than it was when you were younger, that in fact, like a good wine, it's got better.
I actually attribute that to when I was in Australia and I'd done the tour of the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra. My voice was in a pretty ropey state, and I went to a specialist and I had two benign polyps on my vocal cords, and thank God they were benign, but he took them off. And it was a successful operation. But it did change the timbre of my voice. It made it lower, it made it... I lost my falsetto, most of it, which everyone still keeps writing about. He can't get the falsetto, but I still sing the song in the same key. It's just, yes, some of the falsetto's gone, but the actual range of my voice has gotten bigger, and the strength of my voice is definitely much better.
If I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. No, it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song and
this one's for you.
I much prefer my voice now to what it was when I was younger. I look back and I sound like a little, you know, King's College, you know, choir boy. And that's fair enough, that's how it was. But I'm, in a way, fate changed my voice by having this operation. And, you know, thank God it ended up correctly, because some people have had, John Tonkins was the man who operated my throat, and I thank him to this day, because I could have ended up like Julie Andrews or someone like that, which is the most tragic of circumstances. And you couldn't comprehend anything like that happening to you.
But, I mean, you've hammered your voice so much over the years. It's a very strong...
It's a muscle.
Vehicle.
The voice is a muscle. Yeah. The voice is a muscle. The more you use it, the stronger it should get.
And what about the melodies? Do the melodies come as quickly as they once did?
They've always come very quickly. And I've always been told to shut up about it, because I write quickly. And people say, oh, don't say you wrote a musical in 2 weeks. People will think, you know, you didn't take enough care about it. But once I immerse myself in a project, I immerse myself totally in it, and morning, noon and night for 2 or 3 weeks, until I come up with something. And yeah, they come quickly. Some of them are good, some of them aren't so good. And that's, you know, if you have a huge catalog like I do, there are going to be some clunkers in there. But when the work's good, it's really, really, really good. But I've always gotten the inspiration from the printed page. So I have no problem, never had a writer's block.
What's this news we hear about a movie of your life?
We haven't even done the deal yet, but it's very close. But David LaChapelle will be doing it. It won't be a warts and all kind of film. It'll be more like a fantasy movie and fun. A bit like the show tonight, probably.
Right. But basically a movie, and it will need 2 or 3 people to play you.
Yes. I mean, I don't think that one person
can actually keep
up with the weight loss and the weight gain throughout the whole movie, unless Robert De Niro is willing to do it.
Well, we'll
be called
him.
The Raging Queen.
Yeah.
Robert De Niro, yeah.
Now, January the 4th, 2005, there was an obituary in the New York Times for Elton John. But it was, in fact, as you look closer, it was Elton, John. And in fact, it was someone called John Elton.
Elton, right.
And the relatives wrote a thing saying, "You taught us love, respect, responsibility, and joy," which was rather sweet and rather touching. What would you like people to say about you after you're gone?
That I was loyal, which is the number one thing in my life, is loyalty, love, loving, compassionate, caring, generous, kind. That's all you can ask for, loyalty.
And what the strains of what song would you like to come wafting into your room as you're about to leave this earth? What's the last song you'd like to hear?
Going Back by Dusty Springfield. I remember standing outside the Harrah Granada when she was in the Springfields, hoping to get a glimpse of her, which I never did. I always remember she used to wear pink and lilac a lot, and a lot of mascara always. And I just loved her voice from the word go.
What about Sir Thomas Beecham, the classical conductor? He said, "Composers should write tunes that chauffeurs and errand boys can whistle."
Absolutely.
That's it.
It's all about melody. You look at the American Top 100 nowadays, and you won't be singing any of those songs in a year's time, let alone 5 years' time, because there's no melody. And maybe an example, maybe Maroon 5, maybe John Mayer, but they're very few and far between. You know, there's very few people writing great melodic songs. And again, you have to write that kind. You want to reduce people to tears. You want to make them happy. You want them to. A song to be a special part of their life, that they go, "Oh my God, I was there when I first heard that song." Like it happens to me, you know, when I hear a song for the first time, I think, "God, that's so great," and I can remember where I am and where I was when I first heard it. And that's what music does to people. It's uplifting. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Coming up, we travel with Elton John as he takes his campaign to combat AIDS to the main battleground, the townships of South Africa. Back in 1992, Elton John set up his AIDS Foundation to provide money for HIV/AIDS prevention and care. Its key fundraising event is the White Tie and Tiara Ball, held every year at Elton's home. But Windsor is a world away from where much of the AIDS Foundation cash ends up. Our cameras followed Elton as he traveled to the shanty towns of South Africa on his first ever visit.
There's no project that we fund that we don't investigate beforehand. We don't normally work with any governments whatsoever because we don't trust them, or we trust where the money goes. So we usually put money into projects that are suggested to us, and we go out there and have a look at them. And this year, early in the year, we visited some of the projects we fund in Cape Town. It was a really, really eye-opening trip.
Old and abandoned.
All the babies are abandoned babies.
Handsome, handsome, and absolutely gorgeous.
He's a twin.
Not too good. Well,
are they HIV?
Yes.
The mother just jumped on the railway line and the train crashed to her, but the younger survived because he fell in between the railway line.
It was the most incredibly moving and inspirational trip for me because, you know, I've never had the time to go down there and visit the places that we fund. And we've given more than £4 million away so far in South Africa. And when you consider that there's a centre that we fund and it takes £8,000 a year to run it, that, I mean, £8,000 a year, hello. So your money goes a long, long way down there. I came away from South Africa feeling optimistic because the Africans have that great spirit and the great dignity and great, amazing resourcefulness of the women in particular.
And that was summed up in a way, I mean, by that choir that you've met.
We went to the hospital, the McCord's Hospital in Durban, and we went to see people who'd been HIV positive, who'd been taught a skill to sew and use sewing machines to make uniforms for the hospital and selling them through the hospital. And then there were so many of them, and they met, and they had a love of singing. And they said, let's form a choir with no formal background or training whatsoever. And they surprised me by coming out and singing on the steps. They blew me away. I mean, it was so emotional. And there's something incredibly moving about Black South African choir singing. There's a certain timbre to the voices, a certain melancholy, a certain happiness. And on the spot, I said, you're coming to the ball.
Every year, and I throw a ball in June to raise money. And we have, last year we had Mary J. Blige singing it, and we had Donna Summer, and we had Sting. Who else we had there?
You.
Me. We're having a ball on June the 23rd this year, and I want you to come and sing it. You will thrill people with your joy and your passion for life, and that's what we want to show people this year, is that how you people can survive and be so positive and put something great back into life because of HIV and AIDS.
And maybe we can do a song together.
Yeah! 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 Yes!
As you
couldn't learn.
Circle of Life. It's from the film The Lion King.
All right.
Oh, oh, yeah. The line. Yeah. From the day we have first step into the planet and blinking step into the sun.
Wow.
In the circle of life, it's the wheel of fortune. So if you learn that, where's the choir master gone?
I mean, there
he is.
Kelly, it was too short for you.
And then we'll sing it on stage together, okay?
That's right.
Well, there was one young woman that you ended up going into her house. I thought she was incredibly upbeat, considering she actually has HIV.
It's a very small place. You have to turn and go. I'm staying there in the corner.
Yeah.
And I've moved in here. I've been staying here for 3 days now.
Yeah. She's working at an incredible clinic that treats people every day. She's now become a counsellor there. And she's moved close to work into this hut that she lives in, which she shares with her sister and her two-month-old baby.
I can't believe that you're gonna enter here.
Yeah.
I'm still gonna paint and change the door, and but I've got electricity at least.
You have?
Yeah, I do. Great. This is my life.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I've got
spotlessly clean, so proud of it. It was 100 degrees in there if it was anything else. But she looked ravishing, she was beautiful, she was dignified, she was happy.
How many pills do you take a day?
A day, a whole day.
Yeah.
It's three pills, six pills a day.
Yeah.
Three at 9 in the morning and in 12 hours time, which is 9 p.m.
Yeah.
Another three.
And you don't get any side effects from that?
No, I don't have any side effects.
Good. The stigma in this country and all over Africa is such that they don't want to, they're in such fear of being identified as having HIV and AIDS. And in a country where Nelson Mandela publicly said that he'd just lost his son to AIDS, and where Chief Buthelezi has lost two sons to AIDS, and these are two of the greatest politicians in recent times and are responsible for the breaking down of apartheid and bringing democracy to South Africa, these politicians have lost people to AIDS. You'd think that people would still get over that stigma because, you know, they're not poor people. They're intelligent, richer politicians. And yet there's still this stigma.
How well do you think the governments in Britain and the United States are coping with AIDS?
I went to the Kennedy Center Awards in December, and I was a recipient of one of the awards, which was very, for me, a tremendous achievement, being a British artist, and only two British artists have ever gotten them, myself and Sean Connery. And I had a conversation with George Bush, who I'd been very critical of, backstage, and I have to say was very charming and very knowledgeable about AIDS, and he said, we're going to beat this, we're going to do this, we're really going to give money. I think the message is beginning to hit home. This is a crippling, crippling disease that could devastate the world's economy if it isn't checked and it isn't seen to and sorted out right away. Again, you're not going to have an instant solution because the infrastructure is so difficult. But there is progress.